walked out of that hospital having no clue what my life would look like.
He faced an unexpected future of single parenthood. Meanwhile, she was widowed with three boys under the age of three.
We felt sorrow that felt unending, and it felt like my heart was literally breaking in two.
Their paths crossed while helping others trust God through grief.
God's timing made evidently clear that we were going to be a family.
Plus, when her son turned away from God, she began praying that 100,000 prodigals would come home. Lori Wilkerson Stewart joins us to talk about the biblical promises she shares in her book, Promises for Prodigals. It's all on today's 700 Club Interactive. Well, welcome to the show. When his wife died from cancer, Daniel prayed he wouldn't be paralyzed from the pain.
And meanwhile, Brittany had a similar prayer when she faced an unexpected future after her husband died.
Really, I remember the exact moment. This girl walks in, and they said it was with a group of girls, but I only saw one, and it was Lindsay. She had like that radiance about her, that light. At 19, she was diagnosed with cancer out of nowhere. It was caught early enough to where they were able to get rid of it. 21, 2 years later, it showed back up. And this time it was more serious. It required a bigger surgery, hysterectomy. And at that point in our relationship, I had an engagement ring in my pocket. You know, I asked her to marry me. We got engaged. And through the year of engagement, she went through chemo. We started life. Everything was good from there. And we did adopt two children. Cancer showed back up, really out of nowhere again. So my prayers were very bold. It was, God, heal her, fix this. But it turned into quickly a fight for her life. And it meant looking in the eyes and saying, you've got this, stay here with me. And fighting for her life, CPR, crying out to God, please heal her, please bring her back. I found myself saying goodbye to my wife, not by choice. I felt like my wife was leaving, and yet it wasn't that she went to heaven. It's that heaven literally came down to get her. Lindsay went home to heaven August 28th, 2015. I walked out of that hospital having no clue what my life would look like. I had to deal with reality that my wife was no longer there, someone I had known since I was 15. And now I'm in my 30s dealing with a reality that I never thought I would. And so the kids forced me to deal with what was going on. There was no dancing around the topic. They asked where mommy was. They wanted to know when she's coming back. I'm sleeping on the couch because I don't want to be in a bed. It's another reminder that Lindsay's not here. One of the hardest things that month was picking up my phone to text her out of habit, calling her phone out of habit, and stopping mid-dial or mid-ring and knowing that I never will hear her voice again. God spoke to me so clearly. He said, that connection that you desire with Lindsay and that you want, you can have it, but it's through me. And what she's doing right now is worshiping me. And why don't you try that? So I look at that as a pivotal point in my grief of saying, God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to worship you and lift up your name high above all the pain, above all the hurt I'm going through. And I say, God, I'm ready. Whatever you have for me, I don't know the why. I don't get it. Don't like it. But I refuse to waste this pain that I've gone through. And I refuse to allow this to be wasted or pushed to the side. And that's where I started moving forward. God comforted me so much in what I was going through. I was encouraged to comfort others. I could actually speak to a pain that I'd never known before. That as Christians, we're headed home. We're headed to heaven. And our focus should not be outward. It should be upward. And as we look up to what is coming and getting a glimpse of that, even in my wife's death, I realized the best is yet to come for all of us if we trust and believe in God.
My life was so amazing when Patrick and I met. He was my first boyfriend. I was his first girlfriend. So we got married in 2011 and we stood on the stage together and we said, I promise to be faithful through life's pleasures and through life's pressures. I will be faithful to you until Christ calls me home. In the fall of 2015, we had three kids under the age of three and life was crazy and busy, but it was so fun because I felt like I was living a dream. He came home and he always did daddy time with the boys. And so he tucked them into bed that night and would always sing them a song and pray over them. I remember us praying together and going to sleep. He woke up the next morning and he was like, you know, I'm not sleeping much anyways. I'm just gonna go ahead and get ready early to go to work. I said, you look so handsome in your suit and I hope you have a great day. I love you. And that's what I said. And he said, I love you too. And he walked out the door. Went to Bible study and we were studying Revelation and prophecy at the time. And just moments later, my phone rang. So I answered the unknown number and it was my husband's boss on the other line. And he said, hey, Patrick fell at work. We're gonna send a vehicle to come get you so you can come to the hospital. I ran into a hallway full of people with sorrow written all over their faces. And they pulled me behind a curtain and they sat me down in a chair and they said, I'm so sorry, Brittany, but Patrick died. His heart just stopped beating. Patrick went home to be with the Lord on September 29th, 2015. And in that moment, at the age of 25, with three little boys under the age of three, I became a widow. And my entire world turned upside down. We felt sorrow that felt unending. And it felt like my heart was literally breaking in two, but I also felt Jesus just sitting with me and saying, I feel your pain, it's gonna be okay. I'm gonna walk you through this. And I would come in my living room and I just remember falling flat on my face and just crying out to God and saying, God, I can't do this. I cannot do this apart from you. And he was so faithful to use his word to soothe my soul in a way only he could do. In those darkest moments of our lives, sometimes can be the lightest moments of our lives because God is so near to the brokenhearted. And I remember how God would just, as he says in scripture, how he gives widow the songs in the night. And God would give me a new song to sing. And it doesn't matter if you're in a place of utter brokenness and hurt like I was fresh after my husband's death, or here I am several years later, out of it, God is still the same sovereign God over all situations.
When I met Brittany for the first time, one of the first questions I had to answer in my heart was, am I ready to pursue somebody again? And I'm not just making a decision for me, it's for my family. And when I saw Brittany, I saw a future. And that was incredible, and it was very just exciting.
The Lord was so gracious because I think in every area of your life, after loss and pain, you're so guarded with your heart because you feel like your heart has been trampled on. And so the Lord made it so clear. And then Daniel was so intentional with his pursuit of leading us in the ways of God, yet guarding our hearts in the process until God's timing made evidently clear that we were going to be a family.
I brought Ethan and Aubrey with me, and they loved being around each other so much that by the time they left that weekend, they were crying about leaving each other. And so that was really encouraging for us moving forward.
I remember one night, Peyton had been praying and they had been praying for a new daddy. And I was thinking, what in the world are y'all thinking about? I said, well, buddy, it's not just about us. Like, God's got to bring the right person. He said, well, I think I know someone. And I said, you do? And he said, what about Mr. Daniel? I think he would be a great daddy. And I said, well, that means that, you know, Ethan and Aubrey, and he said, would be my brother and sister. And I would really like that, Mommy. So we got married on July 16th, 2017.
And just continued on with the crazy and the wild and the love and the beautiful part of bringing kids together.
After we announced our engagement, people started calling us the Brooker Bunch because we are a blended family and the last name is Brooker. Our life is like a circus. I feel like we're a traveling circus. It's so crazy because we have five small children, abnormally close in age.
Yeah, enjoying the first, creating these moments that you know, maybe I had as a child or that they wanted to do.
So for our family, there is always a road of joy and sorrow that intermingle. Now, this is part of our story. And you know, Patrick will always be part of my story and Lindsay will always be a part of his story.
I think as you go through pain, it's okay to admit it. It's okay to be real because until you address it, is not going to heal. God is not wasting your pain. He's not wasting anything you're walking through. He sees you and He cares, and we want you to live out a life that is full of joy, full of love and passion and pursuit. And we have to make a decision that no matter what we walk through, we have to trust and believe that that is still waiting for us, that that is still ahead.
When you feel like your life is over and there is no hope ahead and you feel like you're drowning in pain, just reach up to the hand that is trying to pull you out, which is Jesus. So if there's one thing I can encourage you with, is keep hoping even when it hurts.
Those are words to live by. Keep hoping even when it hurts. And for Daniel and Brittany, there's plenty of reasons to give up hope. Here you are, widowed, with young children. Where do you go with that? And God gave Daniel a very special revelation that if you want contact with your wife, you can find it through me, because she's right here with me, and she's with me for all eternity. And that is the hope we all have as Christians, that we will spend eternity in Him and with one another. And that is the precious hope of the church, that regardless of what's happening to our outer bodies, regardless of the decay that comes to all of us, regardless of the death that comes to all of us, there is this hope, the hope of the resurrection, and the hope that when we're absent from the body, it just means we're present with the Lord, that the veil is taken away, we behold Him face to face, and we're with Him. If you're going through a grieving process, many people I know this year, it just seems to be a year of grief. To minister them, sometimes you just have to sit with them and to hear their story, hear their cry. If you're going through that, take the words of Daniel to heart. Don't turn away from your pain. Express it. Feel it. Don't try to quench it. Let it out. Realize that you can pour out your complaint before Him. He is able to take it. He understands what it's like to lose a child. He understands what it's like to die. He understands what it's like to go through pain. He understands what it's like to have rejection. He knows all of that. He's experienced all of that. And so He's able to share that with you, and for you, be the God of all comfort. All He's waiting for you to do is to express it and to draw near to Him. But do it in hope. Do it in hope that one day you are going to be with Him. One day, all the tears are going to be wiped away. One day, we're going to be with Him in heaven. If you need someone to pray for you, we're here for you. All you have to do is pick up the phone and call us, 1-800-700-7000. We're not here to judge. We're certainly not here to condemn. We're here to tell you there's a God who loves you. His very name is love, and He wants to bring that love to you. And all He's waiting for you is for you to ask for it, to say, here I am, could you reach me? Call us, 1-800-700-7000. Terry?
Still ahead, a mom with a message all parents need to hear. Promises for a prodigal child. Here are the declarations that can lead to a breakthrough in your family when we return. On January 1st, 2011, Lori Wilkerson Stewart felt God giving her an unusual message. It was a verse from Jeremiah, and it said, "The Lord is with me like a violent warrior." Well, as soon as she read it, she knew she was going to have a difficult battle on her hands that year, but she knew she wouldn't be fighting it alone.
Lori Wilkerson Stewart and her husband, Matt, come from a long line of pastors on both sides of their family. Lori never imagined that any of her children would ever walk away from God. So when one of her sons wanted to live contrary to God's word, Lori was brokenhearted. But she found peace and learned how to pray for her wayward child. In her books, Promises for Prodigals, Lori shares the prayer she declared over her son and why she wants to see others pray their way to a breakthrough too.
Well, Lori is joining us today, and it's great to have you with us. I'm excited because I think there are so many people out there who have children that are not walking in the faith they've been raised in or don't know the Lord, even though families have come to Him, and this holds such promise. Let's begin, before we talk about the books and what you've done there, to go back to 2011 and what happened at that point.
Well, my son at that time, I have three kids. My oldest son was a senior in high school, about to graduate. And up until that point, I mean, we had been the perfect Christian family, and all the kids were serving God.
You guys were pastors.
Yeah, pastoring a church, had just planted a church. And we get a phone call, and a trusted relative let us know that there was a lot of things going on in our son's life that we were not aware of. And when we confronted him about that, he did not repent of it. He wanted to continue to go in that direction. And it was a lifestyle that it was completely contrary to God's word. And even after explaining all that and talking to him and extended family, getting involved, talking, he was dead set on that was the direction he was going to go. And it just crushed us.
What do you do when confronted by something like that as a parent, Lori? Because I think the struggle for parents is, this is my child and I love him or her so much. But at the same time, you feel as a believer the responsibility to honor the word of God. How did you and Matt handle that?
Right. Well, we had to have those hard talks with him and just let him know, hey, you know, we're raising you guys under the word of God. And if you're not going to follow that, and if you're going to go against that, it's not okay to live here and live that way. And so he moved out after graduating, and it was...
That must have been so hard.
I cried. I cried so much. And that's when I knew I was literally going to lose my mind or get on medication or something to be able to function if I didn't get serious about praying and spending time with the Lord.
So you went to the Lord, which is what we all should do when we're in those moments in our lives. And God gave you a prayer strategy.
He did. I had taken 3 days off to pray and fast because, you know, some things are only broken in the spirit world by fasting. And I think what broke was not necessarily in my son's life, but it was in my life. God just, he broke me down to raise me up and to build faith up again. As I searched his word, as I began to just spend time with him, listening to his voice, I began to find so many promises in the word of God. And I daily was kind of searching those out, underlining them in my word. And then at one point the Lord said, Lori, you need to start writing them down in a journal so that one day you can give those to your son and show him, this is what mom did for you, son. You know, these are the promises of God that I've been declaring over you all this time. So that's, I actually have the original journal here that I wrote 100 promises from the word of God.
Were you a journaller before that?
Off and on.
Yeah.
But boy, once I got that assignment, and it was about 3 years into the process when I got really serious about writing them down. Mm-hmm. And that, I can say honestly though, Terry, early on after I fasted, God gave me such a supernatural peace that everything, in fact, the word the Lord gave me was, this will end well. Mm. And I've just stood on that word along with all the promises that, you know, it's been 7 years, but
yes,
there will be a good ending to this.
Well, 7 is the number of completion.
Amen.
Talk a little bit about finding the promises, because we all know the story of the prodigal son and the word, and we know what happened there, but you went far beyond that and found 100 promises for prodigals.
Yeah.
What were some of the favorite ones that
you
found?
Well, there's a ton in Isaiah. There's the one I like there says, you know, I will fight for you. And I will save your children. Mm. And there's another one that says, your children will come back to you. They will be like jewels and bridal ornaments that you will display for all to see. And I thought that was so beautiful. And then there's one in Ezekiel that says, the Lord will search for your lost loved ones and will bring them safely home again. And then, of course, Luke says he leaves the 99 to go after the one.
That.
And then there's one in Hebrews that I love. I have to mention that. There's specifically, the writer says that angels are sent by God to care for those who will receive salvation. Mm. So right now, I've been declaring all this time that angels are protecting my son. He's been in some seedy places, but while he's there, there's angels watching over him, and he's under the care of angels.
And we know that none of it is ever wasted, that in due time, when he comes to himself and back to the Lord, it will not be wasted. You've written books for a book for boys, the Prodigal Promises for Prodigals, and one for girls. You had an experience with your sister when you were 17 that sort of played into this as well.
Right. Well, growing up, I'd watched my parents go through a similar situation with my sister. She was a prodigal, and she actually was an alcoholic for over 20 years. But when I was 17, my sister actually tried to commit suicide, and she ended up in a psychiatric hospital. And when I found that out, I was a senior in high school. I didn't know what to do with myself. I went for a run, and I began to pray. And in that time with the Lord, I began to shout at the devil. And I said, "Satan, I'm so angry for this one soul you've tried to take. I'm taking 10,000. Mm-hmm. God, give me 10,000 souls." And I didn't know how that was going to happen. I believe God's been doing that through some of the work that I've been involved in here at CBN. But also, then years later, this happens to my own son. Mm-hmm. And when that happened, I got really angry. And I said, "Okay, it's on now. This time I'm taking 100,000 prodigals with me to heaven. And I don't know how you're going to do that, God." And I believe that the books are part of that. Mm-hmm. That's why I made a separate one for guys and girls, because it's such a... There's places to write your prodigal's name in there. And I just think the pronouns need to match the name. I'm big on that. I used to be an English teacher. And I'm funny about that. But it's just such a personal thing for parents and for grandparents and for aunts and uncles that are praying for their prodigals. You know, it's just an intimate time with the Lord.
It's a wonderful opportunity to circle the wagons around whoever the prodigal in your life might be, whether it's your immediate family or extended family. But Lori has done the work for all of us. Let me just say thank you for sharing your story. And for parents, there are two versions of Lori's book. Promises for Prodigals has a guy's version and a gal's version. Both are available through Amazon, or you can find out how to get a copy by going to CBN.com. They're next to my bed. I think you'll probably want them next to yours. Thanks.
Lori. Gordon.
Well, coming up, peace on the battlefield for one night.
When German troops started singing Silent Night, French and British Scottish troops started answering.
The World War I Christmas truce when we come back. Well, this Christmas season, we're asking you to join us in a Robertson holiday tradition. Every year, we give a special gift to those in need, and that gift is equal to the money we spent on either our Thanksgiving dinner or our Christmas Eve dinner or our Christmas Day dinner. So when you do that and you send a special gift of $25 or more, we're going to send back to you two exclusive holiday treasures. One is a new classic, My Father Reading a Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens, and that'll be on CD. And then plus CBN Documentaries presents Christmas, the story behind their traditions. Now, this documentary was filmed in 8 countries, so it's going to take you around the world to discover the history of Christmas, the meaning behind the traditions that you love to celebrate. And here's a clip from that documentary. Take a look. In the winter of 1914, World War I had been raging for 5 months, and countless soldiers on both sides spent Christmas in trenches all over Northern Europe.
1914 saw millions of armed men facing each other on a line from the English Channel to Switzerland. They were dug in. They were very close to each other. They were within yards of each other, the Germans on one side and the French, the British, the Canadians, Australians on the other.
On Christmas Eve, German soldiers placed candles and Christmas trees on top of their trenches. Then a few of them began singing Stille Nacht, or Silent Night in German.
The 19th century produced a number of German carols that were in translation. And so both sides, for example, knew Silent Night. And so when German troops started singing, French and British Scottish troops started answering.
The artillery fell silent, and the two sides shouted Christmas greetings to each other.
We have numerous examples of troops meeting in no man's land, sanctioned by low-ranking officers who thought this was a useful opportunity to scout, maybe to recover some dead bodies, but allowed all kinds of exchange of gifts, different foods. Apparently the British wanted sausages and the Germans wanted French wine and British canned beef.
The break, which lasted through Christmas night, became known as the Christmas truce.
They very often played soccer and swapped pictures of families and then went back to killing each other the next day. It was really a moment of 1914, seldom repeated.
Well, that was a sample from our new documentary, Christmas, the Story Behind the Traditions. And if you're interested in how did we get here? How did we get the various traditions of Christmas? Why is December 25th the date that we celebrate Christmas? What's all this about Christmas trees? Why do we bring a tree into our house and decorate it? Why do we hang stockings by the fire? Why do we have live nativity scenes? It's our gift to you when you give us $25 or more to help those in need. So if that's you, give us a call, 1-800-700-7000, and say, yes, I want to help others this Christmas season. Here's a word from Romans chapter 5, and hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us.